I, let's say, as a progressive, report having no bias. My implicit measures show that my bias is up here, it's high, let's say. So that difference is what we focused on. But now we're looking at entire groups of people. We're looking to see if in a sample of people, the person who reports the highest bias on a 7-point scale or on a liberal to conservative scale, so let's say I happen to be one of those people who ends up anchoring the conservative end of the scale when I'm asked, am I also then going to show greatest bias when looked at the implicit measure? So now we're looking at a correlation. Is a person who ends up reporting stronger levels of conscious bias also in this array, in this rank ordering, somebody who sits at that same high level on the implicit measure? And here the data are telling us a very interesting story. Looking at something simple like political orientation, these are data from the website that some of you may know. It can be found easily by going to implicit.harvard.edu and taking some of these tests. There are several tests there that tell us something about people's implicit levels of association between categories of people like black and white, thin and fat, and the concepts good and bad. And what we do is simply plot. This is, remember, not an assessment that we're making of the subject. This is something the subject is offering to us. They can choose to tell us that they're conservative or liberal. We don't care. But we use their own self-report of where they sit on the political spectrum, and then we simply plot the level of their biases observed both on the conscious measures and on the unconscious measures. And this is the pattern that we roughly see. As the person's own self-reported labeling goes from strong liberal to strong conservative, so does the person's expressed, in this case, implicit level of bias. So in this case, greater anti-black bias, greater anti-Arab bias, greater anti-gay bias as political orientation changes. Okay. So John played a clip from, who was it, Rush Limbaugh. And what Rush Limbaugh is upset about is that the fact that we're saying that somebody who happens to be conservative in orientation, by default, we're now going to assume that this person is going to be more racist or more biased. And, you know, the data I'm going to show you should just build a case that actually that is the case. Now what I'm going to so argue at the very end is that the least that honest conservatives can do is to say, yes, we are. I've been pushing this about liberals. I've been saying to liberals, look at the difference between your expressed bias and what we're seeing on these tests. Look at that disparity. And I've been doing that for a long time. I think it's time to also look at the conservative end of the spectrum and to say that it may be time for a certain kind of honesty there as well. And there are some wonderful conservatives who are honest about this set of beliefs that they have. So they will say, I am conservative and I am racist. But I'm talking about an increasingly large group of people who say, I'm principled conservative. Phil Tetlock is an example of somebody who's proposed this particular concept, that it is possible for human beings to be principled conservatives. That is, they believe, for example, that the government ought not to help disadvantaged people, you know, get back on their feet. That's such a strong belief in individualism and such a strong belief in equality of opportunity, that's what that view represents, not any sort of racism, so to speak, or any kind of belief that people who sit at the bottom of the pile have to remain there. And so what we're going to look at is whether there's evidence for that sort of neutrality or not. This is a very busy slide, so I don't expect you to make too much of it. I will just tell you that this goes back to measuring what we might call explicit forms of ethnocentrism, you know, a general disliking of things that are foreign or different from oneself. And these come from those early psychologists that I mentioned in the post-war years who came to the United States studying authoritarianism and looked at, you know, how is it that people who have certain kinds of beliefs that disregard those who are different from them in race, in sexuality, in class, whatever it might be, does all of that fit in? In other words, is a person who is anti-black also the same person who will be more likely to be anti-gay and anti-poor and so on? I mean, there are lots of positions that had been taken saying they need not be connected. And this work of theirs showed, and we are replicating it here, that indeed there's something that we might call a latent variable called explicit forms of ethnocentrism, in that all of these load on pretty highly and make a nice, meaningful psychological construct that has some bearing that's called implicit ethnocentrism. We come along and we say, aha, but let's look at it in some other form. Can we measure the same sorts of things in implicit form? We find that those hang together as a separate little cluster, different from each other, but look at the correlation between the two. Back to this idea that these, what we had been thinking of as somewhat separate systems in the brain actually have some kind of a porous membrane, because the same factors, the same things about our biology or upbringing or the culture that affects one does end up affecting the other, but they're not the same. That they sit in slightly different places, they do their work in different ways, they're responsive to different kinds of input. And so the message from this busy graph is to take away two pieces. Yes, it's important to pay attention to these two as if they're separate, because statistically, all of the tests tell us that they're not collapsible into one form. There is a conscious part, there is this unconscious part. But let's not kid ourselves that they're completely separate. They do hang together. And I believe ultimately when we talk, I think data that will come from Aaron Kay and others today, going to show us how situations can change these things, how what appears to be something that's fixed in the mind actually isn't, that it is quite malleable. And I think that when we look at that, this particular result will have some. How much time do I have? Do you know? 10, okay. Okay, let me mention this result to you again. I'm going to take what is a complex graph and just simplify it for our purposes. The important thing is to look at what the reach of something like ideology might be. And here we had a bizarre sort of thought of what we wanted to try. We wanted to see how far can you go away from a particular kind of an attitude or preference for a certain group and look at its effects on things that seem to sit far away. So if you go back to that NES survey, on the one hand we said, you know, if you say you're liberal or conservative, it explains 85% of the variance in who you're going to vote for. Okay, those are two things that sit very close to each other along the spectrum. Not a big surprise when they correlate. Okay, but if you're a Yale undergraduate and you love Yale very much, does that predict how much you will hate Arabs? It shouldn't. Okay? These are two quite different forms of attitudes. But in Kristen Lane's work, which was done both at Yale Law School and then a data collection that we did in this room, I think, with Harvard Law students, shows that the degree of in-group preference for your own organization, your own school in this case, which we would regard to be a positive kind of an attitude, one that we want to nourish and so on. But we've got to know that that does tend to be related, not minimally, to an anti-Arab bias, such that the stronger the love for Yale and Harvard, and the greater the disregard for the other. This test was a Yale-Harvard test, so it actually, the more pro-Yale you were, the more anti-Harvard you were, and the other way around. And each group shows nice, strong in-group preference. So we know that that's pretty robust. It's in opposite directions, as we would predict. Again, you know, and same thing with identity, belonging to the group, the association between me and Harvard or me and Yale predicts anti-Arab bias. So I just sort of put this there again to say that we've got to, again, take into account the fact that there are these biases that we love, the ones for our sports teams, for our schools, and so on. I think we want to get to that at someday and say, you know, what do we want to do with these? But for now, let's not forget that they may have an underlying association. I believe that this may have something to do with an individual person's own orientation towards their relationship to all kinds of social groups. Do we become members of them? And this is where I think that for those of us who vary on the implicit form of this association, so much more is the burden to think about conscious strategies that need to be generated in order to disrupt them if we should wish to do that. Okay, so that's going to be the question. This is a very different type of data, so I just want to say in 15 seconds what the nature of the data are, because they're not what they typically tend to be, and then I'll just whip through four slides that will look exactly the same. I'll just show you. These are four slides. For all practical purposes, they're the same. They're two election. These are data from two different elections, the Bush Gore election and the Bush-Kerry election. And here we're not looking at the data from individual people. What we did is took the web data on which we get measures of, let's say in this case, we're just going to take one test, pro-white, anti-black bias. And people vary all the way from showing strong pro-black bias to strong pro-white bias, mainly strong pro-white given the kinds of subjects, but thousands of them, including white and black. And what we're doing, and we didn't ask them, who are you going to vote for? So we don't have a measure of bias and preference for candidate. But what we do have are data that are congressional by congressional district. So if you take the country and you break it down by congressional district, one of the things you can do is look at each congressional district and look at the proportion of that district that went to Bush over Kerry, Bush over Gore. So you can get a measure of the strength of that district's voting in that election, and then all we do is plot congressional districts. Okay?